This is the first of three videos where I'll be looking at Ernest Shackleton, one of the biggest names in early 20th century polar exploration. In this part, I'll be giving you an overview of the man and his life, and in parts 2 and 3, I'll be watching the 2001 miniseries about his most famous expedition, the well-named Endurance Expedition. In that video, I'll be pointing out each and every time he's a dick, because out of all the polar explorers, Sir Ernest was, in my estimation, the biggest dick. He's not the worst person, though. That honour is very hard to place. But I think I'll go with Peary. I mean, it's hard to outdo selling Inuit corpses for profit. Ernest Shackleton was born in Ireland in 1874. And unlike many British polar explorers of the age, I'm calling him British because Ireland was part of the UK at the time, he wasn't a nationalist, and he lived in England from fairly early on. Anyway, unlike most famous British polar explorers of the age, he wasn't an officer in the Royal Navy. His family couldn't afford the cadetship, so he joined the Merchant Navy instead. He decided he wanted to be a polar explorer based on a dream he'd had in the Navy, that his ship would sail onto the ice at the edge of the world. And it kinda did. He accompanied Robert Scott on the Discovery Expedition of 1901. Together with Wilson, who would later die with Scott, they made an effort for the pole, and while they didn't succeed, they did reach a new further south. Planning was sloppy, all their dogs died, and Shackleton came down hard with scurvy. On the return journey, sometimes he'd be carried with a sledge. Scott blamed Shackleton for the failure of the mission. Unfairly, a lot more went wrong than just his scurvy. There was an uber-polite Edwardian bust-up, using terms like professed rogue, and they became rivals. Some years later, in 1907, Shackleton returned to the Antarctic with his own expedition, the Nimrod Expedition. Because Bugs Bunny was yet to be invented, Nimrod wasn't an insult yet. He'd been told by Scott to keep away from the area they'd previously explored, because he felt that the area was his. Shackleton agreed, and then went anyway. He achieved a new further south, and could have made the pole, but he calculated that he didn't have enough supplies to get there and back again. Apparently, he explained his decision to turn back to his wife by saying that he thought she'd prefer a live mouse to a dead lion. Okay, so far it all sounds reasonable, and returning when so close to the prize is unusually rational for a polar explorer. But then the third expedition happened. This was the Endurance Expedition, and like Scott and Terra Nova, he brought a cameraman who turned the events into a documentary. So enjoy the footage! Now this was after the pole had been conquered by Amundsen, and Scott is long dead. So Shackleton decides to one-up them by becoming the first person to walk across Antarctica. Anyway, before I go into any more details, here's a clip from a documentary forgetting what the South Pole is.
Their plan was unparalleled in polar exploration. After landing on the north coast of Antarctica, Shackleton planned to walk the 800 miles to the South Pole. He would then keep going for another 700 miles to the south coast.
The south coast of Antarctica?
Oh dear.
The south is in the middle of the continent. But hilariously, there is actually a south coast of Antarctica. It's just not where they said it is. There are small pieces of coast that snake around just enough to face the pole, technically making them the South Coasts. But that's not what the documentary was talking about. Anyway, the Endurance Expedition. The name is prescient as hell because they didn't get the chance to march across Antarctica. Hell, they technically didn't even reach the continent. They got frozen in the pack ice for months, the ship eventually sunk, and Shackleton takes his men on the ship's tiny lifeboats, ill-equipped for polar conditions, to seek help. First, they land on Elephant Island, 350 miles away, one of the most isolated places on Earth. The first people ever to land there. Elephant Island, so named because it was grey, jutted out from the sea, and not covered in an abundance of flora and fauna. The bulk of the men are left on a barren rock, with some wildlife and vegetation, while Shackleton and a small party head for a whaling station on the island of South Georgia, some 720 miles away. The seas are cold, and the small ship's in constant danger of being overturned, but they made it, landing on the wrong side of the island. So Shackleton has half his men stay with the boat and rest, while he and two others walk for help, becoming the first people to ever climb the mountains between their landing spot and the whaling station. The Endurance went down in November 1915, and they arrived at the station in May 1916. It took some more months for his men in Elephant Island to be rescued, but ultimately all Shackleton's crew were saved. It took some more months, because ice is a bitch. There's a reason they were the first people to land at Elephant Island, and they were very lucky when they arrived. Okay, so far this doesn't sound dickish, it sounds impressive, and it was. It really was. He deserves his place among the great explorers, but that's not all he did. Firstly, the legend of the Endurance Expedition is that none of the men died, and that's true, if you only count Shackleton's men. The Ross Sea Party was sent separately to the opposite end of Antarctica, with the mission of setting up supply depots for the second half of the march across Antarctica, and they ran into trouble. Their ship was sent north in a gale and locked in pack ice, leaving a barely supplied shore party of 10 men cold and alone, huddling in a wooden shack near the coast. It would be 20 months before anyone came to help them. It took so long that Shackleton was aboard the rescue ship. He'd had the time to get to safety, recover, and rescue the Elephant Island team before anyone came to rescue the shore party. They'd spent their time battling scurvy and setting up as many depots as possible for Shackleton's march. The Ross Sea Party was the only part of the Endurance Expedition that succeeded. And Shackleton himself was frankly awful. Here's an example. Harry McNish was the ship's carpenter, a socially awkward man who seems to be in Spectrum. His best friend on board was the ship's cat, nicknamed Mrs. Chippy. Chippy because Chippy was a nickname for a carpenter, and Mrs. because they're almost inseparable. And here he is, Mrs. Chippy that is. He was a he. And that's not McNish, that's Percy Blackborough, the youngest member of the crew, a stowaway who Shackleton once, jokingly, threatened to eat. When the ship was crushed, Shackleton decided to shoot all the animals, because they never survive any attempt at escape. Dickish, but understandable. McNish was obviously unhappy, fair enough, Mrs. Chippy was his best friend. The cat was shot and they began the effort, dragging the lifeboats across the ice, because to begin with, Shackleton had another destination in mind, Paulet Island. Eventually, McNish had enough and refused to go any further. Shackleton's plan was insane, he said, because getting to Paulet Island would require dragging the boats over 60 miles of jagged ice, a journey that would surely destroy them. McNish also yelled that as the Endurance had sunk, Shackleton legally had no control anymore. Usually be correct, but Shackleton had inserted an extra section into the employment contracts that said he's the captain until he returned to a friendly port, ship or no ship. You see, this was a private venture, not the Royal Navy, so the rules were usually a little bit different than something like the Franklin Expedition. By some accounts, Shackleton explained this calmly, by others, he explained it while threatening to shoot McNish. Regardless, McNish had his way and the journey to Paulet Island was eventually abandoned, and instead Shackleton set his eye on Elephant Island in South Georgia, both requiring much less boat pulling over jagged ice to reach open water. McNish was the man who used whatever scraps they had to turn the boats, designed for short journeys in much more clement weather, into something that could last hundreds of miles in the Antarctic Ocean, and it worked. They made it to Elephant Island. There, he had to do it again, shoring up the least damage to the boat, the James Caird, for an even longer, stormier journey, and he did it. He was one of the men left on the beach as Shackleton climbed the mountains of South Georgia. So far, you're probably thinking, this doesn't sound too bad. Tempers frayed, but both did their jobs, and shooting the cat was tragic, but kinda necessary. But Shackleton personally saw to it that McNish was denied the Polar Exploration Medal that most of his men got due to his insubordination. Insubordination that was caused by the guy shooting his best friend and then damaging their only way of escape by dragging the boats across the ice, following a plan that he was sure was doomed to fail. A plan that was then abandoned and they survived. McNish was arguably the man who deserves the most credit for the survival. Shackleton gave the orders, but McNish actually did the work. With almost nothing, he did miracles with those lifeboats, and he ended up unrecognized because Shackleton was a dick. McNish ended his days destitute, drunk, and homeless in New Zealand and was buried in an unmarked grave. In the 1950s, the New Zealand Antarctic Society placed a headstone, and in 2014 they added a bronze statue of Mrs. Chippy. Mrs. Chippy himself has been immortalized in stamps, art, film, and even opera for children. Once home, Shackleton and a number of his crew signed up for World War I. Shackleton was too old and weak to go to the front and was sent to Argentina as a diplomat. He failed to convince him to come into the war on Britain's side and he was sent home again in 1918. After the armistice, he made a final voyage south in 1922 and died of a heart attack in South Georgia before the expedition properly got underway, thus proving the one frozen thing he couldn't survive was his own cold heart. Join me next time, and I'll point at all the times as a dick and a TV thing that's meant to be glorifying him. Oh, and one more thing that's a complete tangent. In 1907, the Irish crown jewels went missing and have never been found. And who did it has never been established, but at least some historians think that Francis Shackleton, Ernest's con artist brother, was involved.